Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air number 10, and there's 6 questions. But first, a nominator. Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened is the Blessed Buddha. Actually, there is 13 questions, but I think it's too much for 1 hour, and the uploads become too cumbersome. So we take the first 6 questions today, and then the next 6 questions on next Sunday. The first question is how to cultivate and harvest grain and paddy fields and other kinds of food according to Buddhism. I mean, without killing insects and without spraying pesticides. How did farmers at the Lord Buddha's time do this? Yes, this is actually an interesting question that also has bearing on vegetarian food, because it's impossible, even without the use of pesticides, which one should of course avoid. By all means, then it's impossible not to kill insects and worms, especially when plowing and also harvesting with machinery. It's impossible, and it was also at the Buddhist time, because plowing, if you go behind a plowing, whether it's animal plowing or tractor plowing, you see there's hundreds or thousands of worms caught. Some of them survive, but most of them they die. So that's impossible. So this means that even those who eat a strictly vegetarian diet, they also are indirectly involved in harming other beings. And it's impossible to stay on planet Earth without directly or indirectly come to harm other beings. So harmlessness, ahimsa, in the absolute sense, is a really difficult thing, which actually implies going to another place where there is no other beings living in your immediate surroundings, such as Nibbana. The formless level will be another level, and also the higher devil levels. There are also very few beings, so you don't harm other beings just by being there and taking food. There is a story from the Tipitaka which has some relevance to this. This was Mahakasapa, the great forest monks, the great forest monk, and the father of the Sangha, he who held the took initiative and held the first council 3 months after Buddha's death, where it was put down among 500 arahat, awakened, fully enlightened monks, what the Buddha he actually said, and then it was recited in unison, and this is basically the Tipitaka we have today. So we know what he said, because 5 arahants, enlightened beings, who had been his company for more than a decade, in most cases, and in some cases for more than 40 years, they knew what he said. Most importantly, Venerable Ananda, which has a photographic memory, which could memorize everything the Buddha he said and everything everybody else said immediately after they have said it. So therefore, we ascribe with some certainty, very large confidence in the Tipitaka texts, the Pali Tipitaka text, which is undoubtedly the best source of what the historical Buddha Gautama he said during his 40-year-long teaching period. Nevertheless, Mahakasapa, he was living, before he became a monk, he was living with his wife in a huge mansion he had got after his parents died, where there also was a lot of workers and a lot of paddy fields and other kinds of fields, and there was a kind of like a big barren kind of place. And so then one day he went out the fields and saw his workers working, and then he saw some plowing and where worms were killed en masse. And then he asked, who's responsible for that? And then they turned around and said, you are. Because he was the one, he was the boss for this place, and it was he who, if there was any surplus from selling this harvest, then the money will go to him. So he was ultimately responsible. And he went back astonished by this and shocked by this. So shocked that he decided the same day to leave the place and go forth into homelessness. And he did that, and his wife also did that. And they were followed to the next village by their crying workers, which suddenly, during one day, lost both their lord and his wife. They went off. They gave actually the house and the fields to the workers, but still these workers felt like they were alone. So this harming other beings by harvesting is a major issue, and is, I think, not realistically fully curable, and neither were it at the Buddhist time. That goes to say also vegetarians are not completely innocent. That's sometimes seen when people start on the noble path and start in spirituality, then they also insist on being vegetarian. The Buddha didn't insist on that. It's a matter of you can say what to eat vegetarian food or to eat animal food. One can eat as little animal food as one can, but still there's a lot of beings killed just by being here on planet Earth and going around and eating food, whatever food you eat. So it's really difficult to attain complete harmlessness. We monks are not allowed to grow food. I have considered this, and I still consider it, maybe doing it anyway, to grow food as possible, as harmless as I can. But we're not allowed to dig in the ground, net up because of this worm issue, and also other insects are in the ground. We're allowed to use earth that has not been used for 3 months, one rainy season, because then it's not inhabited by worms and insects. Or we can cultivate vegetables in pots, and that's maybe an option I will take up. But otherwise, it's very, very difficult. And then one should think about this, because this is a part of the dukkha issues of being in the world, that one inherently, at the human level, harm other beings by just by being in the world and eating normal food, even vegetarian food. Question two, that's a tricky one. Just wondering if there is any chance to explain the double slit experience through the prism of the Buddha-Dhamma. Could you please elaborate on this in one of your Dhamma talks? Yes, I will elaborate it. This is probably the most important experiment within the last 300 or 400 years. It was performed by a young doctor in 1805, so it's more than 200 years ago. And he took a very neat, very simple experiment. He wanted to know what light was, whether it was a particle or a wave. At that time, the prevailing thought was that it was a wave because of prisms and diffraction and lensing and so on, this only wave phenomenon. But nevertheless, he took a plate, then he cut one slit in it, and then he put light through. Then what did he see on the screen behind the slits? One slit. He saw one stripe. Then he put another slit, and he used monochromatic light that only has one color. For example, laser light, but other kinds of monochromatic light, only one color light, can also be used. Then he had two slits. I can just draw them with a pen here, then you can see. Imagine two slits cut here, like this, in the paper. Then I have a lamp here, and then it shines through the slits and then up on a screen. What do you see? Yeah, the normal question is to say, I see two stripes of light on the screen, but you don't. And that's a really tricky issue here, because now you see a zebra pattern that is light, dark, light, dark, light, dark, light, dark, light, dark. Also in the middle, where the slits are not, there also. The intensity of the zebra pattern is most in the middle, and then is falling out. All the zebra patterns has the same distance. You can calculate the frequency of the light, that is the wavelength of the light, from the breadth of the black stripes and the white stripes, black stripe, white stripes. And that's called an interferometer, and that's the way you measure with an instrument the wavelength of light. So what's the big deal here? Yes, if it were wave, then you would not see. then if it were particle, you can say, then it's like bullets. You shoot bullets. Then also when you have one slit, then you have one slit of bullets on the other side. It's a particle. Light particle is called a photon. If you have two slits, then you'll get two light slits, two light stripes on the screen behind the slits. But you don't. So that is to conclude, if this interference pattern, that is this SEPA pattern, it means it's a wave phenomena, where two wave fronts, they go through the two slits at the same time. And then they end canceling each other out, and then they will, at some places, then in other places they enhance each other because of constructive and destructive interference, and then you end up with this SEPA pattern. So now you have actually two questions here, because what is light then? Is it a particle or is it a wave? Then let's say you shoot only one photon at a time. You attenuate the light. You screw down the light intensity. You can also do this experiment with electrons, with neutrons, with carbon 60 buckyballs, with phthalocyanine, which is a molecule at the size of insulin. Exactly the same thing happens. So it's a completely general feature, not only with light, but with all particles in the universe that has mass, and also those who don't have a mass. Nevertheless, if you only shoot one at a time, what happens then? Then you still see the SEPA pattern. And that's really strange, because you can only see the SEPA pattern. If you see one photon coming in, then see what's happening on the photographic plate behind the slits. Then you see only one dot. So this dot says that is a particle, because there is only one dot. You can set a photoelectric counter there also, they will get only one click. However, if you keep shooting on, then this SEPA pattern comes back. And the only thing to explain it is to say, the electron, while it's here, the photon is shoot out here, then it's a particle, and then it splits up into a wave, and then when it hits the screen, then it's a particle again, or the particle aspect hit the screen. But a particle and a wave is not the same. A wave is non-local, it's everywhere present. It's a field of undulation. A particle is local. It has a certain determinate position, and it has a direction, and it has a speed, velocity. So these two concepts are completely complementary, as Niels Bohr called it. One image of what a particle is exclude the other image, the wave aspect. So the particle aspect is one thing, the wave aspect is another. So there, the physicist again was baffled. I would put a link on that with a cartoon graphic explaining the double slit experiment, which is very famous, and which is still up in the air, and which Richard Feynman, American physicist, he called, is everything in quantum mechanics is in the double slit experiment. The really interesting thing is to say, okay, now this electron or this photon come. What happens? Which slit does it go through? If it really is a particle, then it cannot go through both slits at the same time. It doesn't make sense, because particle cannot split up and collect again. It goes either through one slit or it goes through the other slit. But still, we have to conclude, when we look at the SEPA patterns, interference pattern, then it has gone through both slits, apparently. And that's really weird. However, the most weird thing is, and here's the Buddhist explanation comes in. If you put a detector and look at one slit, first you put a detector to both slits. So you want to observe which slit the photon goes through when it passes the slits. Then the interference pattern disappears. Then you see only particle aspect. You see two stripes. as if you have shot bullets through two slits. This means that observation, change, the manifested aspect of all elementary particles in the universe, from, if it's not observed, if it's only observed on the screen, then it's a wave aspect. If it is observed, its locality, where it is, which slit it goes through, then it's a particle, despite the fact that it cannot be both at the same time. Even more interesting, what happens if you have two detectors, but you switch off the one, then the electron goes, it goes maybe not through this, it goes through the slit where there's no detector. What happens on the screen? Still, and the interference pattern is destroyed. How can the particle know that the detector in the other slit is turned on? When it goes through the slit, there's no detector, or it is turned off. You can also take one detector away, completely detector away. Then there's only one detector. But still those particles that goes through the other slit, where there's no detector, still the interference pattern breaks down. This plays a very important, crucial role for the conscious observer to manifest what's going on. Quantum mechanics and Buddhism agree about two things. Quantum mechanics says that two assumptions in classical mechanics that doesn't count anymore. One is locality, that things are a certain place, and secondly, that they cannot exert influence from here to there instantaneously. There has to be some kind of signaling or some kind of touch contact or some physical media that cannot travel faster than the speed of light from one location to the other location. But that's not true. Actually, there is two. It has just been proved last year in Holland with experiment in two imperfect diamonds, where if you measure a valence electron, the spin of a valence electron in one diamond, then 1.3 kilometers away at the other end of Delft University in Holland, in Netherlands, then there's happening a change in the observation of the other electron, valence electron, inside the diamond. So this means that there's no signal going on, but since they are entangled, then you have to conclude there's non-locality. Because if you change something here, it's an instantaneous change happens here. That can be generalized. Whenever you think a thought, the entire universe changes probability distribution. Why? Because you're also made of particles. Your thoughts are also quanta of energy, just like these, whether it's massless or mass particles who has mass, they are also quanta of energy. So this means locality is not does not count in basic physics, and neither does it count in Buddhism. There are also numerous examples on that locality can be contracted and expanded just as one wants. I'm just correcting the light here a little bit because I look like a lemon, very yellow. Anyway, the other assumption in classical mechanics, the mechanics of Newton, is reality. This basically says that whatever you observe, then it was there before you observed. That the Buddha says no. It's only at the moment of the observation that the manifestation comes into being. This quantum mechanics also say that there's no systems in quantum mechanics that has any properties whatsoever if not observed. So it's observation itself that induces or manifests the quanta of energy that is a waveform in its natural form to have a particle-like aspect that has mass that can be observed in a specific position. So it's a whole new ball game, quantum mechanics and Buddhism. It's momentary. It's not real in the sense you think it is. what is that make the quantum mechanical wave function that is an accurate description of which observations you can do also on this screen, and also if you use beam splitters and interferometers, the counts can be explained completely accurately by this quantum mechanical wave function. If you measure many experiments, you get a frequency of outcomes. This frequency can be computed by quantum mechanics before you make an experiment, and is accurate in some sense in some experiments out to the eighth decimal, which is frighteningly accurate. So it says something about reality. It's a probabilistic theory. It doesn't say anything determinate. It cannot predict the next outcome, the next experiment outcome, but it can predict the distribution of outcomes in 10,000 experiments in an ensemble. So this one has to admit, many physicists don't want to admit it still today, but the school where I come from, Copenhagen School, which is still the orthodox interpretation of quantum mechanics, guided by Niels Bohr, Danish physicist, at the Niels Bohr Institute, where I've been in Copenhagen, where I was born, together with Heisenberg, Wolfgang Pauli. And then the next wave of quantum mechanicists, or quantum physicists, there were some who favors a special interpretation, which I also favor, because it fits with Buddhism. And this is called consciousness cause collapse. That the measurement occurs because there's a conscious observer that has set up and prepared the experiment, and that he wants to know something that makes sense to him, and thereby he affects the outcome of the experiment in a very fundamental way. This interpretation is also called in physics the Wiener von Neumann interpretation, after Eugene Wiener, a Eastern European mathematician and physicist, and John von Neumann, which also was an Eastern European physicist and mathematician who came to United States during World War II. They have kind of like, it's an extension of the Copenhagen School of interpretation of quantum mechanics. So it says, if it goes back to the double slit experiments, is the effect of the observer, which focus he wants to observe, is it as the level of the slits, then he get only one result, namely that it's a particle. Whatever comes here, he sets up some experiment here, consciously, of course. How can you set up a detector unconsciously? It's impossible. This affects the outcome of the entire universe, and thereby also the photons and electrons or whatever you shoot through these two slits. He will see only because he wants to know something about locality of these electrons. Which slits do they go through? That's locality. Huh? Which slits is a local information. Then the whole universe looks to him and answer him in the name of particle. If you look at the screen, it doesn't look at the slits. Then he will see wave phenomena. So thereby his choice of directing his attention, his conscious choice of directing his attention, determines which properties, which qualities are manifested for this physical object, which so far has been regarded as independent of mind. But that's not the case. Nothing is independent of mind. Whether you speak of particles, photons, electrons, mountains, trees, world out there, distant galaxies, blah, 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 is always a combination of a conscious observer, nama, and some form out there, rupa. And this duality cannot be broken down. This is really it's the most radical philosophy in Buddhism, which has in modern philosophy called radical empiricism by William James, which also was a philosopher, doctor and philosopher, the first psychologist in the United States. Why radical? Because it takes away the carpet about any idea about reality out there, independent of mind, existing in and by itself. Why empiricism? Because it insists on experience, on measurement, as the witness of reality, and the only witness of reality. Whatever you conjure up of funny ideas about determinism, or probabilistic theory, or superstring theory, or whatever, you have to come back to the six senses, use your six senses and your consciousness to tell what happened in the experiment, and to tell others about what you learned from the experiment. And that cannot be denied. That cannot be denied. Though many physicists actively try to deny it. That's called neglect. Neglect has nothing to do with science. Nothing. I hope this answers this question. I like to come back to this because this is actually my prime interest, because it's very, very particularly interesting, I think, that the Buddha, he said the same as a special, very well experimentally verified theory today called quantum mechanics. He said the exact same for 2,500 years ago. How could he know that without an instrument? And I also found it very interesting that two theories from two different cultures, from each side of the earth, with 2,500 years in between them, they converge on the same image of what reality is, which is a very subtle thing. They converge on the same thing, the same point. This means to me that I smell something that is called absolute truth here. Because if widely different theories, they converge, they doesn't use the same words, but they nevertheless converge on the same point, the same view of what reality, so-called reality, is, and how it behaves. And that is discarding two important tenets in classical physics, and also in naive, realistic view of the world, namely locality and also reality. Some have tried to make various kinds of formulation of quantum mechanics that saves one of them, but neither have succeeded. If you say that one has succeeded, it's called hidden parameters, a hidden variable theory. It was put forward by David Bohm, English physicist, at first. But they have been proven that there is no hidden variable. If there is a hidden variable in the upper sense of that word, then it's the consciousness of the observer. And here, the consciousness of an ant also works, and of a cat, and of a bird, or of a fish, it also works. So it calls for consciousness insofar as the only thing that can flip the energy of the quantum from its wave aspect, which is not directly observable, to its particle aspect, which is observable, local, and have mass. Tricky issue. I've long been considering writing a book about it, and I think I'll get time to it, hopefully before I die, because it's a very interesting issue, and it points to, especially in the Abhidhamma, points to Buddhism being much more than a religion, much more than a philosophy, much more than a religious praxis or a discipline. It points to Buddhism, early Buddhism, what the Buddha said, especially in the Abhidhamma, as the ultimate science, actually. In this way, in this regard, it's worth noticing that the first book of the Abhidhamma is called Dhammasangani. And it can be best translated to enumeration of all phenomena, or classification of all phenomena. So it says something about how systematic it really is. I think we'll leave it at that here. because it's worth a whole Dhamma speech in itself with some good artistic drawings. But I'll put a link to the double slit experiment to those who don't know Thomas Young's double slit experiment and its consequence for our interpretation today of what reality is, and also the measurement problem, which is basically an issue still up in the air, which I actually myself think I have a fairly good answer to what's going on in the measurement, in the moment of measurement. But I think this we can take this further on in another Dhamma talk. We'll just go further on to question three. Question three is, it has been said that after achieving arahat, a layman has to ordain within 7 days. Otherwise he will die. Why is this so? That's not true. He has to ordain the very same day. It's not something they have to do. But if you look at the recordings, all lay people who have been enlightened and become arahat, they ordain the same day. Why do they do that? Because they are so disgusted with the lay state. Why should they run around in the world as a layman? They go forth into homelessness the very same day. And if somebody wants their service, then they say, why don't you do it yourself? Why do you want to involve me in your worldly pursuits? So they have kind of like, they have at that moment they have become enlightened, gone beyond the world. So there's no sense. No, it doesn't make sense at that time to have a job, or a family, or a house, or anything that should be maintained, because that implies more suffering, more frustration, more obligations, more stress. So that the Allah doesn't care about it. He doesn't want it. He sees this in a noble state. He wants to be together with nobles, no others. And therefore, he ordains the very same day. Or, if they don't ordain, then they usually die. This not because they're usually killed the same day. One story was a very famous one about a young ascetic who came to the Buddha and asked him in the middle of the street of a meditation object. And the Buddha first say, no, you cannot ask me here, I'm on Pindabat round, I'm on Begging round, ask me later. But he insisted, and Buddha said, no, I cannot do it, I cannot answer you here now. But he insisted again, please give me a meditation object, because I don't know when I'm going to die. And then the Buddha, he gave him a meditation object. Then this young man, he asked for ordination. The Buddha said, but you don't have a robe, you don't have a bowl, so you have to collect a robe and a bowl before, because otherwise you are not cannot be allowed into the Sangha. Then he went out to find a bowl and a robe. Then he made a cow, a holy cow in India, and it was maddened just by seeing him. So it ran right into and put a horn in his belly, and he fell dead. And the monks then reported this story to the Buddha, that this has happened. And the Buddha then went and looked at him, and then realized that he has become an arahat before, as a layman, after he has reflected going around in the streets trying to find a robe and a bowl, and then he has reflected upon this meditation object he got from the Buddha. Why was he caught down by this cow? If in the Jataka, in Abhidhamma, the story is about this particular man of his prior lifetimes. He's been a Brahmin, a young priest's son, which has bought a prostitute together with a friend. And then they took her out in the jungle and had sex with her. But instead of paying her, then they killed her and took her clothes and jewelry and went back into town. And she was then reborn as a cow for 7 times. And whenever she met these two guys, then she killed them instantly. She ran out. She wouldn't know as a cow why she did it. But she does. Just seeing them once, she would be maddened by rage and run towards them and kill them. And the other guy, who was also a human at that level, he was also killed by that cow. So this says something about it, that either you die from an accident or for something else, or you go forth as a layman into homelessness, anagarika, or you ordain as a monk the very same day. So there's no recordings whatsoever in any history of Buddhist history, not only on the Buddha-Gautama, that ask historical Buddha-Gautama, but also all the other Buddhists before him, that there has been a lay person that became enlightened on day one and still then slipped over to day two and still have not gone into homelessness. This has not been recorded, never. So either they go into homelessness the very same day or they die by accident or by natural causes. So they try as acutely as they can, but some do not succeed because they come to their enlightenment very, very close to their death, and they are not reborn after enlightenment. I hope this answers this question. Question 4. Can indulgence in Facebook, YouTube, internet for porn, etc. be considered an intoxicant? No, not strictly speaking. It's not an intoxicant in the sense that it breaks the fifth precept. But it's bad business anyway. Both whether it's addiction for porn or addiction for information or just surfing the net. Any addiction is an addiction. Any craving and clinging to whether it's internal object or external object, visual or auditory or gustatory or whatever. Any clinging to any object that is impermanent will cause suffering, because you cling to it, and then when it's ripped out your clutch, then sorrow. So it can be it's basically serving the internet, whether it's for porn or for information or for press or for stories or for films or for whatever entertainment purpose, then it's kamachanda, sense desire to see and hear something, usually on the internet, to see various forms, various colors, and to hear various sounds. And then you can say for mental states also being told various stories. So is kamachanda is an allowable, it's not breaking the fifth precept, but it's an allowable on from day to day basis, but yet not on the poya days, on observance days. They're all entertainment. You break that to sukhansa, like train on each observance day, on full moon and on new moon, not to have any entertainment shows or perfume or take food after 12 noon. Just to train it, how to cool down this kamachanda, this sense desire, which is the main thing driving the world and beings, is desire to see something, to hear something, to smell something, to taste something, to touch something, and to have various mental states. Primarily those, for example, orgasm, which is connected with a large pleasure, and also intoxicated mental states, such as smoking marijuana, drinking alcohol, smoking cigarettes, and all these kinds of things, drugging in any kind of that word. So this is what runs the world, basically, is running after this sense desire. It's a whole flood of sense desire. Kamaraga, greed for sensing. It keeps beings here. If they have this, they want to see something or hear something or sense something at the moment of death, then they come back and have a new rebirth. So the Buddha often is seen ask dying monks, so what about it, friend? Is anything you want to see? Then they typically ask, no. Anything more you want to hear? No. Anything more you want to smell? No. Anything more you want to taste? No. Anything more here in this world you want to touch? No. Anything more you want to experience with your mind? No. Then you're ready to go. It's when you say enough, enough is enough, it's all the same, then you have made some progress on the path. Question 5. there is no God, then why is Sakka the chief of the 33 gods and Brahma spoken of repeatedly in the suttas? When we say there is no God in Buddhism, it means that there is no monotheistic God that has created the world. Some Brahmas, they think they have created the world because they live one universal cycle. And that's the story worth telling. Is so what happens when there's a big crunch, big bang, big crunch after 100 million years? Where do the beings go? The conscious beings that has not attained enlightenment. Then they have gone up to the Brahma levels. So the world doesn't burn and conflate up to beyond the Brahma levels. So they survive there. Then they fall down when their karma has been exhausted, as all other beings. Then the first Brahma, he comes into, for example, the earth system of this planet Earth and the solar system. There's no planets there. So the gas from the new Big Bang has not just condensed to the level of forming planets. Then he says to himself, there's nothing here. I'm the first one. Which is true, because he was the first one who fell down there. So he said after, let's say, 200 million years, his eyes could be fun if there's some details here. Then 200 million years later ago, there's some small dust particles condensing because of gravity in the space. And then there start to build up planets over several hundred million years. Then he says to himself, before there was nothing here. Then I wished there should come something here. Then something came. Then he mistakes that it was his intention to have something be there, that it came there. You can say on the quantum mechanical level, he can actually be involved because he's an observer in manifesting things, but the main driving force probably is gravity and small particles clutching together to each other. And then they whirl on and then they build up over several hundred million years. But nevertheless, so he make the interpretation, the false interpretation, that is him who has created it, so that he's father of the world. Then other beings fall down to his level, and he tells them this story, and they see he's older than them, and so they think he's the father of the world, and he has created everything. Then they all fall down here, later on in their karmic career. Then they would become, because of this remote remembrance, they would become, have a tendency to become monotheistic, because they believe this faulty story that the Mahabrahma told them. And he also will believe in a monotheistic story when he comes down here, if he's not a megalomaniac who becomes a Hitler or Mao or Stalin or like that, because he thinks he's a big shot. So there's 31 levels, we're level 5. Sakka of the 33, he is a god, but he has not created the world. He's not a god in the sense of a creator god, a monotheistic creator god. He is a god in the sense of a deva, which means a shining being, of which there's many, 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 many on higher levels. And that actually is these 12 levels in the Kama Loka, 16 levels in the Brahma Loka, where they have another form of body, then we have another form of form. Then there's Arupa Loka, where it says 5 levels, where you have no form, only consciousness. All these are to be regarded gods, but none of them have made the world. That's an important distinction. Secondly, the monotheistic god in Christianity and in Islam, and also in Hinduism, they are eternal. They are eternal. But they are not in Buddhism. They can have very long life length, but it's not eternal. That's an important distinction, because the top guys, they live 84,000 universal cycles, but still this is not eternal. At the first level up, they live 50 million years. Yes, but 50 million years is very little compared to one universal cycle, which is 100 billion years. So time again is kind of like a harmonica. You can fold it out, fold it in. Doesn't matter, because also the speed of time, the speed of change at these levels goes much slower. Every time you go one level up, the speed of time goes a factor 4 down. It's an interesting feature because this also relativity, Einsteinian relativity says if you have two reference frames, and I think it's two shells of space-time that is rotating in between each other. This means that an observer here, he will measure a time that goes slower in the outer shell that is rotating around him. And so also with the next shell and next shell. So I think it's a big time, space-time onion, where there's shells that is rotating around each other, because that would fit with special relativity, which says that an observer in one reference frame will experience or measure a time delay or time expansion, time dilation in the other reference frame. If it's moving linearly, these two reference frames are moving linearly relative to each other. Or if they are rotating around each other, same thing, with a constant speed. So this space-time onion fits with special relativity, it fits with Buddhist cosmology. That's interesting also. So the cosmology Buddha sets up fits with Einsteinian relativity. Second issue. So there is two scientific revolution in this millennium. One is special and general relativity of Albert Einstein, 1905, 1915. The other one is quantum mechanics from the late 20s, early 30s. Both the worldviews of these two, which defeats naive realism completely, they fit with the explanation the Buddha has put forth. Despite he lived 2,500 years ago, despite he had no instruments. So that's, I think, very, very, very interesting. And it can hardly be by chance. Huh? I'm just trying to get the lights right here. The light's changing outside. Okay. So that's answer this question. There is Devas. Many Devas in Buddhism, but there are no one single eternal creator God. No one single creator God, like there is in Christianity, like there is in Hinduism, like there is in Islam and many other religions as well. Do all that reside in the 31 levels throughout time follow the teaching of the Dhamma taught by the Buddha? No, they don't. They don't. Usually, those who are at the main positions, same as this level, not all humans are Buddhist, not even all at the main positions. But if you go up, there's a general feature, or general, you can say, tendency to with the king and his ministers, they are Buddhist because they were Buddhist before they came there, and it was Buddhism that put them there. For example, Sakka, which is two levels up. Sakka and the 33. Why did they become the 33? It's because they were Brahmins at the time of India, had access to Kassapa Buddha, and also the Buddhists before him. And they were told that you should do good. And then these Brahmins, these young guys, and it was a band of 33 people, they went around from village to village and built ponds and schools and bridges and everything that could be that could increase the common good in that particular village or small city. When they died, they ended up on the 33 levels as a consequence of their good doing. They did good their entire life. So they went actually, literally speaking, from village to village, from city to city, and then stayed there as long as the project took. And they invested their own money, and they dig the ponds with their own hands, and so on. So they really dig significantly good, and it was kind of like a mode of living for them, lifelong good doing, from the time they was kind of like converted until they died. And so, as a consequence of that, they are still Buddhists there. Sakka, he's a noble. Furthermore, he's a Sotapanna, So this means he has attained the 25% enlightenment that I have talked about in the other Dhamma talks. So he's a noble. Funnily enough, Sakka is called Indra in Hinduism. Further up at the up, you go up to further than step 13. There's a Mahabrahma and the Brahmas. One Brahma Sahampati, he was the first after the Buddha's enlightenment. The Buddha's look out in the world. Is there anybody here in this human world who can understand the Dhamma I just been enlightened to? Then he said, no, there's no one. It's too subtle, it's too complex. They cannot understand it. They're not even interested. And then at that time, Brahma Sakampati said to himself, ah, the Buddha will not teach. My world will perish. He looks down at several galaxies as pearls or jewels on a pillow, on a dark pillow. But at the same time, he can see in detail. So they have kind of like free zoom. They can see in detail and overall at the same time. They read information directly, non-locally. So nevertheless, he immediately manifested in front of the Buddha, put his robe in order to the one side, covered only one shoulder as I have now. And then he went down and bowed in front of the Buddha and say, and ask him three times to teach. Because, as he said, there are a few beings here with a little dust in their eyes, and they will be able to understand the Dhamma you have been awakened to. And then the Buddha, he agreed. And then the Brahma Sahampati thereby withdraw to his Brahma level, very satisfied, because now he knew he had done significant karma, extremely good karma, by making a Buddha teach, by specifically asking him to do it. And the Buddhists cannot say no. They won't say no. They will never say no to a request to teach the Dhamma. So it cannot come higher than that. He saved the whole world from moral perish into barbarism and pedophilia and what have you. He saved the whole world right there in the front of the Buddha by kneeling down and requesting him to teach. So also Brahma Sahampati is a Buddhist. So this means that two gods of the most important Hindu gods, Hindu believes that Umtvat, you are that, and that's basically Brahma. Brahma is everything, he's everywhere, and he has created the world. What they don't know is that some Brahmas, not all Brahmas, but some Brahmas actually are Buddhists. That's funny, huh? And secondly, but you cannot explain that, because of course they would be very opposed to you that you say that the one they worship actually is a Buddhist. He worships the Buddha. He don't worship himself. Secondly, Indra, which is the same person as Sakka, he's also a Buddhist. He's even a noble. So two of their main gods are not Hindus. They're not Hindus. Two of the main Hindu gods are not Hindus themselves. They are Buddhists. But it's difficult to say. It's something usually we in the early Theravada tradition go silently with. But since you're looking at this video, I think it's okay to tell it. So, no, not all Devas are Buddhists. And some are even evil, very evil, seething evil. And same thing at this level. At the human level, some are good, some are bad, some are very evil, and some go around killing other beings, and it's just only very few who are actually Buddhist. We say traditionally 250 million, maybe 400 million if you take also Mahayana Buddhists in the world. 400 million corresponds to something like 5% of 6 or 7 billion human beings at the planet Earth at the moment. So this means that it's a minority. And basically it's the last mountain you have to climb on your spiritual path, where one becomes all these other things, one can, all these other philosophies, not only religions, but philosophies and context, cultural context one can pass through. Then Buddhism is the last one, the very last one, before attaining Nibbana. May you do so by this speech. 54 minutes and 58 seconds for today. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhasa. May you and all beings become thus happy, thereby worthy, anava, and perfectly self-enlightened. Is the blessed Buddhas. Remember to click subscribe. I think it's there. I'm almost sure. There. Click subscribe there and send in your questions to me, bhante.samahita@gmail.com. Thank you for your attention.